Love, love, see it all, but I shall. Sir. Still to the Sutta's Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki
Jai. Srila Founder Acharya Srila Prabhupada Ki
Jai.
BBT Founder Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Namacharya Srila Haridas Thakur Ki Jai. To the assembled devotees, all glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the lotus feet of Sri Guru and Sri Gautam. All glories to Sri service must be unmotivated and uninterrupted to completely satisfy the self. Please repeat. The supreme occupation, Dharma,
the supreme occupation, Dharma,
for all humanity,
is that by which men
can attain to loving devotional service unto the transcendent Lord.
Such devotional service
must be unmotivated and uninterrupted to completely satisfy the self. Perfect. In this statement, Sri Suta Goswami answers the first question of the sages of Naimisharanya. The sages asked him to summarize the whole range of revealed scriptures and present the most essential part so the fallen people or the people in general might easily take it up. The Vedas prescribe two different types of occupation for the human being. One is called the Pravritti Marg, or the path of sense enjoyment, and the other is called Nivritti Marg, or the path of renunciation. The path of enjoyment is inferior, and the path of sacrifice for the supreme cause is superior. The material existence of the living being is a disease condition of life. Actual life is spiritual existence, or Brahma-bhuta existence, where life is eternal, blissful, and full of knowledge. Material existence is temporary, illusory, and full of miseries. There is no happiness at all. There is just the futile attempt to get rid of miseries, and the temporary cessation of misery is falsely called
happiness.
Yes. Can anyone just repeat what I just said?
The temporary cessation of misery is called happiness.
Thank you very much. Okay. Therefore, the path of progressive material enjoyment, which is temporary, miserable, and illusory, is inferior. So material enjoyment is three qualities:
temporary,
illusory,
and inferior.
Yeah, miserable. Temporary, miserable, and illusory. But devotional service is to the Supreme Lord, which leads one to eternal, blissful, and all cognizant life, is called the superior quality of occupation. This is sometimes polluted when mixed with the inferior quality. For example, adoption of devotional service for material gain is certainly an obstruction to the progressive path of renunciation. Renunciation or abnegation for ultimate good is certainly a better occupation than enjoyment in the diseased condition of life. Such enjoyment only aggravates the symptoms of disease and increases its duration. Therefore, devotional service to the Lord must be pure in quality, i.e., without the least desire for material enjoyment. One should, therefore, accept the superior quality of occupation in the form of the devotional service of the Lord without any tinge of unnecessary desire, fruitive action, and philosophical speculation. This alone can lead one to perpetual solace in his service. We have purposely denoted dharma as occupation because the root meaning of the word dharma is that which sustains one's existence. A living being's sustenance of existence is to coordinate his activities with his eternal relation with the Supreme Lord Krishna is the central pivot of all living beings, and he is the all-attractive living entity or eternal form amongst all other living beings or eternal forms. Each and every living being has his eternal form in the spiritual existence, and Krishna is the eternal attraction for all of them. Krishna is the complete whole, and everything else is his part and parcel. The relation is one of the servant and the served. It is transcendental and is completely distinct from our experience and material existence. This relation of servant and the served is the most congenial form of intimacy. One can realize it as devotional service progresses. Everyone should engage himself in that transcendental loving service of the Lord, even in the present conditional state of material existence. That will gradually give one the clue to actual life and please him to complete satisfaction. Jai Śrīla Prabhupāda ki jai. Om Agyana Timirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshuram Militam Gena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Svayam Rupa Kadalayam Tadati Svapadantikam Vande Maham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Parakamalam Shri Guru Vaishnavam Shcha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunatham Vitam Tam Sajivam Sarvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakanditamscha Hey Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagapate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Dakta Kanchana Urange Radhe Vrindavanishwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpa Tarubhyascha Kripa Sindhu Devacha Patikana Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shivasai Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare.
Verse again, survive from some parunda only to bhakti and hope to jay hug to kyapriti hata yatma supersedati. The supreme occupation, dharma, for all humanity is that by which men can attain to loving devotional service under the transcendent Lord. Such devotional service must be unmotivated and uninterrupted to completely satisfy the self. So as Śrīla Prabhupāda mentions here at the beginning of this purport, that this answers the first question of the sages put to Śrīla Goswami. The sages of Nandisharanya asked how many questions?
Six
questions of Śrīla Goswami, all extremely pertinent, valuable, and important. And this first one, anyone remembers the essence of the first question?
What is the best good for all people?
Yeah, what is the ultimate good for everyone? What is the way that, or what is the the highest activity for everyone? What is it that everyone can perform? What action or activity can everyone perform in order to receive the highest benefit? So, actually the first question and the second question are very similar. The second question is, what is the essence of all scriptures? But similarly, what is the essence of all scriptures? So that one can perform and act according to the essence of those scriptures. And today's verse 6 and tomorrow's verse 7 answers question 2. And as you'll hear tomorrow, is pretty much the same answer. So what is the ultimate good for everyone? What is the action or activity that everyone can perform that will bring them the highest benefit? Thank you. Excellent. See? The sages of London, Sharanya. the pure devotional service. Pure devotional service, and so many amazing points are brought out here in Srila Prabhupada's purport and the verse spoken here, I guess, by Sudha Goswami. This question is something that's very valuable for all of us. Now, when I think about the good for all humanity, one pastime comes to mind of Ramanujacharya, who was given the sacred mantra after intense service to his spiritual master, and he was told, when given this mantra, that this mantra can deliver you from all the miseries and sufferings of the material world, has the power to deliver everyone, and by your intense dedicated service, you've become qualified to receive this mantra. So I give this mantra to you, and then, you know, you can be delivered. It can give you ultimate happiness. And he was given that mantra, and he was told that he should keep this mantra secret and not give it to anyone else, that if he were to share this mantra with anyone else who is not qualified, then basically he would suffer hellish life, and in his next life he would be born in hellish worlds and just suffer for lifetimes, that he would be cursed or doomed to suffering. So, Ramanujacharya began chanting this mantra, and by chanting this mantra he began to experience extreme levels of bliss and cessation of misery and suffering. And in this elevated position, he was able to see the intense suffering of others. As often happens, when you're in the thick of things, you don't really see it so much. Like, we meet so many people who will look you in the eye and smile and say, "But I'm happy. I'm happy." You know, you say, "We're giving these books, we're trying to spread love and peace and happiness around, we're trying to make people in there look at it, and I'm happy." And they mean it. At least on the surface, they think they're happy. They're really convinced that, you know, I'm doing pretty good though. I mean, things are okay for me. And, you know, I'm happy that you're happy. But I'm already happy. I don't need this stuff to make me happy. And so people are an illusion and they're thinking that they're happy. And it can be bewildering for us sometimes. I remember once meeting a guy on book distribution. He was riding this bike and we were in Covent Garden. And he rides up and I stopped and we had this nice little interaction about bikes and exercise and being healthy. And I said, "Look, we're giving these books out to all the nice people and I'm just trying to help people become happy." And he's like, "But I'm so happy already. I mean, look at me. I'm like healthy and fit. I got this nice bike. I got a good job. I got a nice girlfriend. And I just work around the corner. I live here in Cincinnati." It's like going on. And he's like, "And I'm so happy. And I don't need to stand out here on the street and, you know, in freezing cold and give books out to people and, you know, to be happy." And then he wrote up. And I thought, "Oh, he seemed really happy." I mean, he looked really happy. And, I mean, he's got a good job with probably some money and so many things. And oh my God, I mean, I'm standing out here. I don't have a penny to my name. Bank account's empty. And I'm thinking, am I doing the right thing here? I mean, come on, is this right? You know, that guy, and I had to think about it when I was sitting for a minute thinking, okay, maybe I took a wrong turn at Albuquerque or something. You know, what am I doing here? Because he was really convincing. And then somehow I just thought, you know, yeah, well, he seems so happy now, but he could ride his bike down this cobbled street right around the corner and hit a wet patch, you know, and just fall over, smash his bike up, smash himself up, you know, and then get a phone call saying his girlfriend's left him because he can't work, and you know, and this whole thing could be destroyed in a matter of seconds. And all of a sudden, all the whole platform of which he's based his entire happiness is ripped out from under him. And then where is his happiness? Because his happiness isn't substantiated on anything that's lasting. It's all temporary, and it can all go at any moment. Any moment, you know, this healthy person can just lose his health. You know that story of the man who beat cancer, he became so healthy, was traveling around the world giving lectures to thousands and thousands of people, trying to help them to become healthy, teaching, and he became known as the world's healthiest man. And you know, and he was like, you know, wanted everywhere. People wanted to hear from this person, and he was so healthy, and you know, beat cancer, and was just the prime of his life. And he walked out of one seminar, and he got hit by a bus. So he was so healthy, but you know, so what? I mean, what is the physical health is not going to last anyway. Prabhupada says here, the nature of the material world is disease. Dis-ease, unease, not ease, but no ease, disease, suffering, misery, that is the nature of this material world. So this happiness that, you know, materialistic personalities are basing their life upon, it has no foundation. It's completely temporary. And actually, they know, underneath, while they're smiling like this and saying, I'm happy, actually they're gritting their teeth thinking, I am suffering like a dog, but I'm not going to tell anyone. I'm going to make it. I'm going to be happy, and I am going to... Right? But actually underneath, people are suffering like anything. Everyone's searching, they're feeling so lonely, they're desiring something, they're wanting fulfillment, and they're not finding it. But they're willing to satisfy for whatever they get, be satisfied with whatever they get, and try to like pretend that this is the real happiness. But if it goes, then it's all over. Their happiness is gone. So Ramanujacharya, he got this mantra, and he was becoming free from all of this distress and anxiety and suffering, and he was able to see the complete suffering of so many people. And he decided that actually I should share this mantra with everyone. It's, you know, how can I alone, you know, attain liberation, attain freedom from suffering and distress and disease, and watch all of these people suffer? So therefore he gave the mantra to everyone. And as he was giving the mantra to everyone, everyone was chanting very loud this mantra that's meant to be chanted silently. And his spiritual master heard everyone chanting, and he immediately called for Ramanujacharya, and he, you know, he called him before him, and he was furious. He was so furious. He's like, I knew it. I knew you were going to betray. I knew you were going to, like, do the wrong thing when I gave this mantra. That's why it took me so long to give it to you. And now look what you've done. Exactly what I told you not to do. You disobeyed my order. You disobeyed the rules. You know, what is your explanation for acting in this way? And Ramanujacharya explained that, actually, how can I sit by and watch so many people suffer in this world when I've been given the gift that can free me from all suffering and can free everyone from all suffering? So if the consequence of giving everyone else the opportunity to be freed from their suffering means that I have to go to hell, then I'm prepared to do that. So I'm prepared to go to hell so that all of these other people can be free from suffering. And at that point, his spiritual master began to like shed tears, and he offered obeisances to Ramanujacharya, and he said, actually, you are my spiritual master. Actually, you have understood the purport of this mantra. Actually, you understand, and I am now learning from you. Your compassion is so deep. So this is the desire that we should be cultivating within ourselves, that we want to give the highest thing to everyone. And this is why the sages of Naimisharanya are asking Sutta Goswami, what is the ultimate good for everyone? I mean, they're not sitting there, what is the ultimate good for everyone so we can just sit here? At least we know what the ultimate good is, right? The ultimate sages want to give the ultimate good. They want to know. Tell me what is the highest perfection for everyone so that once we've understood it and assimilated, we can give it. We can share it. We can assist others. So in this way, the sages of Naimisharanya are pulling forth from Sutta Goswami the essence of what is the perfection of life, what is the goal, and what is that goal? The goal, the dharma for every living entity, the natural constitutional position, where Srila Prabhupada explains that which sustains one's life, and that which sustains one's existence, the natural activity for every living entity is to attain to pure, loving, devotional service to God, to Krishna. So that's the nature of every living entity, is to love God, to serve God. Now, we may be in forgetfulness of this ourselves to a greater or lesser extent, and personalities outside are in deep illusion and forgetfulness of this. We're being convinced at every moment that the highest perfection for every living entity is to enjoy the senses. I saw yesterday one bumper sticker, one life, live it. You know, there's a lot of different ways you can, but the whole point was, you know, just do everything you can in this life. Just get it all out of your system. Right? That's kind of the mentality. And in one sense, Prabhupada mentions the pravritti marg and the nivritti marg, and that's also, in a sense, the Vedic idea is, okay, you have the desire, so get it out, engage it, you know, it tries to pick you up where you are, the fruitive path, the karma kanda, at least do something, but offer the fruits to, you know, do it in a religious way. But these people, we're not, you know, people, materialistic people, are not doing things in a religious way. They're enjoying it in an extremely irreligious way. So the mentality of the materialistic person is to enjoy the senses, whereas a spiritualistic person, a devotee, is understanding that actually pleasing my own senses is not going to bring me the highest, you know, level of consciousness. It's not going to take me to the perfected platform, and it's not going to completely satisfy me. What will completely satisfy me is to please the senses of Krishna. Rishikena Rishikesha. So to please the senses of the controller of the senses, to water the root of the tree. The hand, the body, the stomach, you know, all of these parts together, the hand becomes disconnected and thinks, let me satisfy myself. You know, do-do-do-do-do, I will enjoy, I will eat whatever I like, or the drink, I will drink the water, I will eat the prasad, you know. Imagine your hand stop putting the prasad in your mouth in the morning, and just crunched it up, and tries to stuff it in, and enjoy. But what's going to happen? Nothing. The hand is eventually just going to die, and wither away, because it's disconnected from the whole. But when the hand feeds the mouth, which feeds the stomach, which nourishes the whole body, then the hand is perfected. Its position is perfected. But if it's trying to enjoy separately from the body, then it's completely useless. Although it may think it's enjoying, but it's actually completely useless. So in the same way as Prabhupada explained, we water the root of the tree. When we please Krishna, when we give everything, when we sacrifice trying to please our own senses in trying to serve Krishna and please Krishna, then we become happy. We actually feel satisfaction. But as long as we're selfishly trying to enjoy or selfishly trying to manipulate the situation so that I'm still getting some pleasure out of it, to that extent, we're not performing pure devotional service. Ahoitukya apratihata. First one, ahoitukya means?
Unmotivated.
My dear friends, or in the words of His Holiness Satchinanda Maharaj, my dear devotees, I pose the question to you, what is your motivation for performing devotional service? Why are you here? Why do you stay? Why do you continue to perform devotional service? Search your heart. Search your mind. What is our motivation? In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna explains that four different types of people usually approach him. They are the... That's right. And artha means seeking
wealth.
Artarti means?
Artarti seeking wealth. Artarti is distress.
Trying to get free of distress.
What's that saying?
Artarti is trying to get free of one, someone wants to get free of distress.
Yeah. Artarti. Arti is?
Artarti is trying to get rid of the distress.
Artarti is
seeking of wealth.
And then?
Jigyasu
is? Inquisitive. And?
Gyani
is the?
Searching
for absolute truth, searching for knowledge. Actually, all of these are described to be on the material platform. So if we come in a distressed situation, we're seeking relief. Our motivation is just some relief. If we come seeking some wealth, that's also wanting something. That's a motivation. If we come inquisitive, what's this all about anyway? Just seeking some kind of answers to some questions. And then the highest is knowledge, seeking that one's actually coming looking for the answers. But even that is considered on the material platform by Krishna. It's the highest of the material platforms, but it's still. But when one actually comes to the point of performing devotional service, approaching Krishna, asking Krishna not what he can do for me, but what can I do for you? Whatever it is that you want me to do, I will do it. And I have firm faith that whatever it is that you need me to do, then if I don't have the qualification to do it, then you will supply it. Absolute and firm faith in Krishna that if I surrender to him, he will take care of everything. Even if it doesn't seem to fit the way that I think it should be. You know, we think so many things, right? We're always thinking, it's like this should be like this. Who thinks it should be something different? Be honest. Who's thinking that things should be a little different? It shouldn't be like this. Who's thinking like that? Honestly, come on. Oh, come on. It's like, why is things going like this? This is wrong. Anyone thinking like that? This isn't right. This is wrong. But who's saying that? Me. I. Right? I'm thinking like this. But Krishna is perfect. Krishna is perfect and complete. And if we're actually performing service for him, then maybe something that's going on, if it's coming back to us, if things are occurring around us, if our mind is bewildered and thinking, oh, this is that, and this is, then we're probably, to some extent, conditioned and are motivated to get something that we want, right? Arjuna, he wanted to go to the forest, man, and just sit on the kusha grass and chill out. And get away from fighting. No, this is a little too much, you know, I'm going to suffer, I'm going to go to hell, I'm going to cause, like, you know, dissolution of the family and family values. You know, I'm not going to be able to joy anyway, Krishna. Even if, you know, if I kill everyone here, they're going to be dead. So what's the use of having the kingdom? I may as well just go and do the right thing. That's right. Because I won't be able to enjoy it, I'm going to go and do the right thing, which is? Chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna. Maybe, you know, whatever. He's going to chant in the forest. But he was going to leave. I mean, this is Arjuna. I mean, he's a pretty exalted personality, right? I mean, he's the greatest warrior on the planet. He's able to fire the, you know, he's Eka Akura. And he's able to just fire the arrow right into the eye of the bird. You know, what do you see? The eye of the bird, the eye of the bird, the eye of fire! You know? This is Arjuna. And he's bewildered. He's thinking, if I'm not going to enjoy, then I may as well give up my duty, whatever I'm supposed to be doing. He was also thinking, something's not quite right here, Krishna. Why are you asking me to fight? Can we have a conversation about this? You got about a half an hour? 700 verses? Can we get into that? Of course, I mean, I just haven't figured out how they spoke that in half an hour, but but evidently it was like that. So they had this whole conversation, and Krishna had to keep again and again and again and again explaining to Arjuna that actually, first of all, you can do whatever you like. The bottom line premise is, Arjuna, it's up to you. You do whatever you like. But if you'd like to do what I'd like for you to do, then get your backside out there on the battlefield and start fighting. And don't worry about all the other things that you're thinking about, because I'll take care of everything. Don't worry about it. Just get into it. Just give up all of your conceptions of what you think are right, even if you think it's according to scriptural injunction. But I'm saying to do something else, so do it. And if you have that faith in me, then you'll do it. But otherwise, it doesn't matter. You do whatever you like, but can you hurry up and make a decision? Because I got about a million people here I need to get rid of, so I'm going to have to get someone else in if the job's not for you. Because Krishna's going to do his work, whether you like it or not. So whether we're the person, whether we can rise to that platform and be the instrument in Krishna's service or not, Krishna's going to get done what he wants done. So it's not about whether Krishna's right or wrong, it's about whether we're going to decide to surrender to what Krishna wants. And if we decide to surrender to what Krishna wants, then he takes care of everything. Does it mean that we're not going to experience any difficulty or be tested? Absolutely not. Arjuna decided to fight. Was he still tested? Repeatedly, again and again and again, even on the battlefield after doing what Krishna said. So it doesn't mean that, yes, now I'm going to surrender and it better all be okay. No, it means that you're surrendering to Krishna and he is going to look after you. But you have to keep surrendering again and again. He's going to bring you to the precipice again and again and again. You're going to be tested again and again and again. Am I prepared to surrender to Krishna? And that first thing means unmotivated. Whatever Krishna wants, ahaitukya. Apratihata, again and again and again and again. Again and again and again and again. I will not give you up, Krishna. I will keep going. No matter what you send my way, I will keep going. Now, what is the choice? Okay, so forget that. That's too much, you know. Whatever he said in the class may have been true, but it's too much. Forget it. What's the other option? Well, the other option is simple. You can either try to pivot yourself somewhere in the middle. But Prabhupada talks about what that means. That means you just increase the material suffering and entanglement also. Because you're kind of, it's like trying to have your foot in two boats. Anyone's ever done that? You got two boats and they're on the water and you're like, oh, and they start to go apart. And unless you're like the supreme yogi, you know, you're not going to hang on. Somebody's going to get hurt or you're going to wind up in the drink, right? You're going in. You're going for a dip. So you have to get in one boat or the other. And the people who are in the other boat, they're like, I don't want to hear your Hare Krishna stuff. I don't want to hear anything you have to say. For me, ignorance is?
Bliss.
Bliss. And I'm not going anywhere near knowledge. I'm just going to stay here and live in my little blissful bubble of ignorance. So that's the choice. So then you can either, but if you try to stay in the middle, Krishna is trying to pull you towards him. And you're kind of going like this. We're pulling away. But when we place ourselves in the shelter of the lotus feet of Krishna, actually we can become completely satisfied. We can become completely happy despite whatever situation occurs in our life. We can see, here it is again. Krishna, another test. Can I take shelter of you? How are we going to get out of this one? How am I going to deal with this? How do I take shelter of you? And what happens is we're constantly associating with Krishna. Constantly associating with Krishna. I mean, Queen Kunti's praying, difficulties, calamities, please come, because then I associate with you more and more. Right? Now, it's not that we need to pray like that. If you're very advanced, you can pray like that. It could prove very intense for you in your spiritual life. But you might also get the highest goal, the highest perfection, if you're really on that platform. But we probably don't need to pray for distress to come. At least I've noticed I haven't needed to pray, and it's still coming. So, you know, but we have to be constantly endeavoring to serve Krishna with an unmotivated, with anya vilashita shunyam jnana karmajana vitam anukuyena krishna ushilanam bhakti uttama uttama bhakti, means to follow in the footsteps of Krishna, please Krishna, serve Krishna the way that he desires. And that means free from jnana, free from karma, free from adi, etc. Means the desire for mystic perfections or whatever. Free from any other motivation except to please Krishna and to serve him the way that he wants to be served. But this may not necessarily be an easy thing, but this is the highest thing. And this is ultimately our supreme dharma. This is our nature. Anything other than that is contaminated by the material nature, by the conditioned nature. Anything other than wanting to please Krishna. Now, as Prabhupada says here, he says by performing like this, he says two things. Yeah, he says, this relation of servant and served is the most congenial form of intimacy. Congenial means happy, blissful, by something that is natural to do. Congenial form of intimacy. It's the most blissful form of intimacy available. The servant and the served, the beloved. When we serve Krishna, when we try to please Krishna, whatever the relationship is, but it's still service, we're still trying to please him. And everyone should engage himself in that transcendental loving service, even in the present conditional stage of material existence. So we should try, wherever we're at, we should get on that path. And Prabhupada says, one can realize this as devotional service progresses. So it's not something that's revealed in the beginning. It's something that's revealed through dedication. You know, like I was speaking with someone yesterday, when you go to Vrindavan and you look at Vrindavan. You know, for me, when I first went and I saw, I was like, hey man, this isn't what's in the books. I'm sorry, I don't remember the whole pigs in the stool stuff on the, you know, and you know, this beggar lady, if she asked me one more time for money, I might commit an opera here. You know, and this whole bumpy road and the dust and I'm sick and I got dysentery and hey now, what's going on? This isn't the Vrindavan I came looking for, right? Because if you think it's going to be easy to approach Krishna and be with Krishna eternally, you know, you're fooling yourself. This is the highest thing, the highest perfection of existence. So we're going to be tested. Krishna is going to test us to the core of who we are. And he's going to test us. He's going to push all the buttons that we thought we had it all figured out. As soon as you think you know everything, ha-ha, you don't know diddly squat. Welcome to the real world. You know, I have a really good friend, and he's like professional in his field. He's, you know, he's respected, top, you know, one of the top persons in his field. And he tries to help so many people, you know, in that, through his job. But he's got a situation in his family where even in his profession he's so good, but someone is suffering within that field that he could help them, and he can't do anything. He's almost rendered helpless. And he's constantly facing within himself the fact that I thought I could fix things. And right next to me, the closest thing that I, person that I love, is suffering from something that I should be able to fix and I can't. Where was his shelter? His shelter was in himself. His shelter was in his material capacity. His shelter was in something material. But it doesn't work. It's not like that. On the spiritual platform, Krishna will take it all away. That which we think we can fix or we can control and we can manipulate, Krishna will take it away to show us the only shelter is me. The only way you're going to cross beyond this world, Baba, is with me, not with any of your material attributes. So just surrender to me. And then I'll make all of it as small as the water in a calf's hoof print, and we can step over it together. No problem. But first you're going to have to surrender to me. With no motivation and incessantly, constantly, we're confirming that. This wasn't the class that I was planning to give. I don't know what happened. Please forgive me if I said anything offensive or rude or that wasn't proper. You can chastise me and correct me. Hare Krishna. Nantakuri Vaishnavrinda ki jai, Antara Shrima Bhagavatam ki jai, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki jai, Shiva Prabhupada ki jai,
His Grace Chandra
Sai Guru ki jai, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki jai. Sorry, there's a time for questions.